on Jesus. This week, several notable celebrity folks passed away. Prince, probably the most famous. He had a front page story on the Washington Post, above the fold. That rarely happens when somebody dies, unless they're a president or somebody. But Prince, he passed away. And the fact is, that should have reminded us that we're all going to pass away at some time or other. And now they're talking about his music, and they're talking about his contributions to society, and evidently they were numerous. But one day you're going to die, and your obituary will appear. And it might not be on the front page of the Washington Post, but somewhere in the paper, the obituary will tell of your life. And what will it say? It'll be in the first sentence. It'll be in the first paragraph. What has your life been all about? Now look at your listening guide. The first and most important thing, we must give attention to the foundation. The foundation. Paul says, I'm like a master architect. I'm a building contractor, and I have laid the foundation, and that is Jesus Christ. He goes on to say, there's no other foundation that can be laid other than Jesus. Now, I know that you can have other foundations. People do it all the time. People who don't know Christ, don't have a religious thought in their head, they go off and they build their lives on all kinds of foundations. But you get Paul's point. There's only one foundation that is secure, that will give you the kind of life you want and the kind of life that will glorify God. The foundation is Jesus. Now that means a relationship with Him. A relationship with Him. I'm talking about you knowing Christ in your life. He's not just an idea. It's not just a set of religious thoughts and principles or reciting a creed, as good as that might be. It's you knowing Christ for yourself. That is so very essential. When you go to buy a house, you look at it, and the first thing that probably gets your attention is the curb appeal, how the yard looks, the flowers, and all of that. Springtime's a great time for that. But then you go inside, and they've staged a few rooms with furniture, if the family's already moved out, some rooms so you can see what it might look like when you live there. And all of that's important. But before you buy that house, you want to make sure you've looked for water damage, and you've checked out the foundation. Remember Jesus' words. Because sure as the world, there's going to be high winds and hurricanes are going to come through, and you want to make sure the foundation of that house is secure. Same as in your life.
Thank you. Good morning and welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. This is Sarah Blackburn. She's given her heart to Jesus Christ and today takes her stand and lets you know of her faith by going through believer's baptism. Sarah, who is Jesus to you?
He's my Lord.
Sarah, on your profession of faith in Jesus, it's with great joy I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Lord, we've done as you've commanded us, and still there is room.
My everything.
Let's remain standing for our scripture reading together. Olivia Bartram will be our leader. Olivia?
Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious.
May his glorious name be praised forever. The whole earth is filled with his glory. I will speak
of your glorious splendor and your wonderful works.
May you be praised, Lord God of our father Israel, from eternity to eternity.
Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the splendor and the majesty. For everything in the heavens and on earth belongs to you.
I assure you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do. And he will do even greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it so that the Father may be glorified in the Son.
In your hand are power and might, and it is in your hand to make great and to give strength to all. Now, therefore, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
May you be strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience, with joy giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light.
There's only one name given under heaven by which we must be saved. Your name is a strong and a mighty tower.
Thank you. please be seated.
Welcome to First Baptist. I'm so glad you're here on a beautiful, gorgeous spring day. You've started the day right, and your week is going to go better because you were here this morning. If you're our guest, special welcome to you. Help us out, please, by reaching into the pew rack and find there a communication card. Fill it out and then hold on to it. And the last thing we're going to do this morning is pass the offering plate, but we want you to put that card in the plate. That's your offering to us today. Thank you for being here. I want us to bow our heads together in prayer. Would you bow with me? Our Father, we come into this place today anxious to meet with you. We bring our problems as well as our victories, our joys and our sorrows. We are here in need of your touch. And so I pray it's going to happen in a song we sing, a scripture we hear, the message, something. Speak to us, and if you will, we will hear and we will obey. Bless those who are far away from us today. Take care of them and bring them home soon back with us here. But Lord, in this place, may your name be praised today. Through Christ we pray. Amen. I want Emily Kane to come up here and Denny Crouch, if you don't mind. I want to talk to you for a couple of minutes. Emily, come on out here. You know Emily. She's often up here leading us in worship with the band, and she does a great job. You grew up at our church, didn't you?
I did. I started attending in high school.
In high school, and now you're well past college and still with us. That's great. Well, you've got a new CD our band put together, and it's called Rise Up Nations. It's available out in the Ministry Connection. How did this come about?
This is a project that the Young Adult Ministry, under the supervision of Joel Harder, had a dream to do, a vision. And the purpose of the CD is, or the album rather, is threefold. First, it's an opportunity for us to collectively come together as a young adult ministry. At the time, we were Encounter, and now we're the chapel service to offer just praise to God. It's also a resource that we hope the church would use for personal times of devotion, for sharing with friends and family, things of that matter. And then thirdly, it's to capture a moment of time of how far we've come as a ministry and where we continue, hope to continue to go moving forward.
Now, it's a live album, and I know it was recorded right here. When did you do it?
We did it in August of 2015. So we've been very excited and anticipating the arrival of the album.
Is something like this costly?
It is. It can cost several thousand dollars to do a project like that. We brought in a producer from out of town who specializes in doing projects like this. So we were able to produce a really high quality album, and it does cost a fair amount to do it.
How were you able to do it?
Largely by the funding of the foundation, and we're very grateful for the generosity of the foundation, because the album truly wouldn't be available and wouldn't probably be without the contributions of the foundation.
That's great. Denny, come on out here. You travel with our senior adults, and I understand you were recently in Maine. Tell me about that.
We were. A few things about the trip shortly here. There were 36 of us on the bus, and we were sharing together as we went along. Carolyn, our senior pastor, is always there.
Wait a minute. I'm the senior pastor.
I'm sorry. It's the pastor for seniors.
Of course, when you have to tell people, maybe you aren't, you know. Go ahead.
Anyway, Carolyn and her great sidekick, Debbie, had us all planned to where we would, with every hour was filled. And so it was such a blessing. And we saw many, many things that God had made available for us in this world to share. And we also started out every day with a devotional. And so that started our day on the bus. And we prayed together, we discussed together, and that started whatever we were going to do for the day in the right way. We met many, many people that we trusted. They saw God in our hearts. And we had lots of time to share together in fellowship. And we had many stories, testimonies, and stories about, if you get old people together, they have many stories from their experience. So it was a lot of fun. But the real point in this whole thing is that without the foundation sharing in the cost, many could not have gone on this trip. Yeah. And so we want to really thank the foundation for letting us have that experience. It was something really out of this world.
Thank you, Denny. That's kind of the recurring theme here. The foundation, apart from our church budget, funds new projects, new ministries, scholarships, things like that, that we're unable to do without them. You were given a brochure this morning that talks to you about the foundation, and I hope you'll take some time to read it this afternoon. And I would like for every church member to join the foundation. There's a card in the pew rack. All you've got to do is sign it if you're a church member. There's no financial responsibility or commitment at all, but we want you to be a part of it. Another project that I was just reminded of, you know, in your program today, there's an announcement about the food fight. 5 million meals we're trying to do in the next few weeks. And our foundation gave a very large gift, a grant to help underwrite that. And I know North Star Network is very thankful for that. So it's a wonderful thing, and I'm privileged to pastor a church that has a foundation to help us do so much more for the kingdom of God. Thank you.
Lord, I surrender all. We say everyone in the world needs Jesus, and we know that we need Jesus, but sometimes you don't know that that you need him until he's all that you have, and you realize that he is right there with you. We serve a great, great God. Would you stand together and let's sing this great hymn, How Great Thou Art. God's people said, amen. Thank you. Please be seated.
I invite you to take your copy of Scripture and turn with me to 1 Corinthians in the New Testament. 1 Corinthians and chapter 3. A passage I go to a lot, and I guess it was word association in my mind this week. I knew today was Foundation Sunday, and I had foundation on my mind. And so we're going to look at the key passage on that. Chapter 3, beginning at verse 9 and following. And on the back of the order of worship, if you haven't noticed it yet, there's a listening guide. And if you'd like to take some notes, there's a space for you to do it. And you can fill in some blanks and have something to think about the rest of the week. Chapter 3, verse 9. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. By the grace God has given to me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and somebody else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, the work will be shown for what it is. Because the day, and it's a capital D in my Bible, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple, and that God's Spirit lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred, and you are that temple. This is the word of the Lord for us today. Thanks be to God. John Ortberg tells the story. Several years ago, the FAA was testing the strength of airplane windshields. They developed a special cannon that would fire a bird into the windshield at the approximate speed of an airplane in flight to see if it could withstand that impact. So they loaded up a chicken, a dead chicken, in the cannon. They fired it, and the test was successful. Well, over in England, they heard about this, and an English locomotive company, they were just developing high-speed trains, and they thought this would be a good test for them. So they asked if they could borrow the cannon, and they were given permission to do it. And they fired a chicken into a locomotive compartment. And when they fired it, the chicken went right through the glass, overturned the chairs, and dented the cab pretty seriously. The British were concerned about that. It hadn't happened with the airplanes. They were concerned. They asked the FAA to investigate, and the last sentence of their report was, it might be helpful if you fired a chicken that had been thawed out first. Somebody hadn't thought of the fundamental questions. They hadn't asked the right questions. They hadn't thought it through. Today, I want us to get very serious about the most important things. I want to talk to you about foundations. You know, in any enterprise, in any entity, in any organization, in anything you can think of, the most important part is always going to be the foundation. What's it built upon? If it's to survive challenges, what's it built on? That's true of building, certainly. The foundation has to be strong to support the building. Jesus talked about that in his Sermon on the Mount. He talked about two men who built houses, and one had a solid foundation, the other had only sand. The one who had built on sand, Jesus called a fool. And the one who had built on solid rock, that was a wise man. He encouraged us to be wise. So it's true of buildings. It's true of nations, too. Our nation, we must be built on a solid foundation. Psalm 11 asks the question, if the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? We should always be asking that question about our nation. Are we building on the right foundation? We've got to be vigilant about that, always. And then there's your marriage. If you're married, you need to build your marriage on a solid foundation. I seldom conduct a wedding that I don't reference Jesus' words. He was talking about building something, and I compare that to marriage. You're getting married here, and you're a Christian, and she's a Christian. Yeah, but is the foundation of your home going to be Christ Jesus? You're going to face winds and floods, rains and storms, earthquakes and all the rest. But if you build on a solid rock, your marriage can survive. You don't have to give up. It can survive. And it is also true of your individual life. Your life. You're building something. You've got dreams and goals and plans, something you want to do. What are you building that life on? This week, several notable celebrities died suddenly. Prince, of course. He was on the front page of the Washington Post above the fold. That rarely happens for somebody dying if they're not a president or something. But Prince, famous for his music, but as we learn, if we didn't know it, also famous for mentoring others and his charitable giving and all of that. A remarkable story. But you know, one day you're going to die too. And your obituary will appear, maybe not on the front page of the Washington Post, but somewhere your obituary will be printed, and your contribution to life will probably be mentioned in the first sentence, certainly the first paragraph. What will it say? Well, that's determined by what the foundation of your life is, and so that's why we're talking about this today. Be very clear about the foundation of your life. Now, Paul says there's only one foundation. He says, I've laid this foundation. There's only one that can be laid, and that is Jesus Christ. Well, actually, there are a lot of different foundations you could have. People do it every day. They build their lives on all kinds of things. But what Paul means is they're all flimsy, and they all will crumble, and they will not last. If you want a life of significance that can handle the storms of life, you've got to be built on the right foundation. If you are buying a house and you the first thing that attracts you to it is the curb appeal, you know, the lawn and the bushes and the flowers in springtime, that gets your attention. But then you go inside, and if the family's already moved out, they've left a room or two staged so you can see with furniture what it might look like if you live there. And all those things are important. But before you buy that house, you better check for rain damage, and you better check out the foundation, because it's most important. Now, Paul says the foundation of our lives is Jesus Christ. That means a relationship with Jesus Christ. Not just having him in your head, not just knowing some things about him, not just going to church occasionally and reciting a creed, but having a personal relationship with Christ. Knowing him in your life. You saw a lovely young woman baptized this morning. She has that relationship. She had called on the name of the Lord, and he came to live inside her heart, and he will do that for you. That is your foundation. That will see you through. But not just a relationship with Christ, reliance on his word. That's what Jesus is really saying in the Sermon on the Mount. He talks about the wise man and the fool. He says the wise man is the one who hears these teachings of mine and puts them into practice. And so if you're going to have the right foundation, it's got to be built on his word. He says that about the church in another place. Paul does. He says the church of Jesus is built on Jesus Christ as the cornerstone, but on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. That means his word, the word of God. The last big building project we had was just a handful of years ago, back in the 1960 education building. We completely gutted it and rebuilt it on the inside. Child care is back there. Our offices are back there. Adult Sunday school classes are back there. But I was here when it happened, and I remember before they finished up the work, before they put in all the drywall and all the rest, they let us go in. You remember that Sunday? They let us go in, and we could write scriptures all over the walls and all over the floors. It would be covered over, but we would know it was there. And I went into what was going to be my office, and I wrote down some scriptures meaningful to me. And I know they're there. That building is built on the Word of God, just as our lives are to be built on the Word of God. The foundation, be clear about it. But now there's something else, and this is really what the apostle is getting at. The foundation has been laid. No one can lay any other foundation. But he says, be careful how you build on that foundation. I'm speaking to people today in the main who have met Christ. You've given him your life. Once upon a time, you said yes. You got baptized too. But the question is, since then, what's been happening? What have you built on that foundation? Now, this is your responsibility. This is your responsibility now to build wisely. Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw. It's up to you. How will you build? When I saw the children this morning, I saw them in the first service singing beautifully. And now some Sundays you come here and the choir loft will be absolutely packed with teenagers singing. And I hear about their mission endeavors and it's just marvelous. And every time that happens, I think to myself, what a wonderful church for a child or a teenager to grow up in. I'm not sure they always realize it at the time, though maybe later they will. What a wonderful church to grow up in, because we give them every resource they need. We launch them into a Christian life that can make all the difference in the world. I don't know any church that does it better. What a privilege to be a part of it. This summer, we're going to have a special class for parents of little ones, giving you even more help in raising your little ones for Christ. Raising children is more than just behavior management. It's giving them the foundation they need for a life of serving Christ. But now, here's the sad thing. And I read about it often, read about it again this week. You take a church like ours, and we've not studied it in our church, but there's got to be some truth to it because it's nationwide. You take a church like ours that has all that we have and all that we do with children and teenagers, and the reality is when they go off to college and they get into their 20s, most of them never come back. They move from the category of religious to being just spiritual and unaffiliated and not involved. Somewhere deep inside, they may still believe, but they're absent from what God is doing in the world. And we're all scratching our heads. Why does that happen? How does that happen? Well, you have a responsibility, parents. You have a responsibility. And students, you've got a responsibility in how you build. We know what one of the problems is across the board, across the nation. Children and teenagers aren't in church as much as they used to be. They're just not here because of other things, other demands on their time, good things, but things that take them away from church. Now, parents, I know you want the best for your kids. You want them to be the best academically. You want them to get into the best schools. You want them to be star athletes, all the rest. You want them to be well-rounded, and I think that's great, but don't forget their soul. Part of the problem is kids aren't in church enough to develop meaningful relationships with other adult mentors. You've got a responsibility in how you build on this foundation. Now, what resources do you have? You've got your pick. You take your pick. Gold, silver, precious stones. That suggests costly things and permanent things, solid and beautiful things. You can put that in your life. Or wood, hay, and straw. That's temporary stuff. That's flimsy stuff. That's cheap stuff. But every day you're making your choices. I'm going to encourage you, as you build your life and your marriage and your church and your nation and all the rest, but as you build your life, you build with the best materials. Put good and worthy things in your life, not things that will suddenly vanish. I was reading this week about the newest trend in building. They say in the near future, big buildings in major cities will not be built with steel and concrete. They'll be built with wood. Can you imagine that? Wood. Pieces of wood glued together and cut and measured exactly right. Building will be a lot faster. It'll go up faster. People who are very committed to preserving the earth are excited about it because wood structures leave a much smaller carbon footprint, and it is a renewable resource after all. So that's all to the good. They're being called ply scrapers. Now, I don't have an opinion about it, but there are two drawbacks that we know of right away. One is the buildings will not be able to be as tall. They just won't be. They won't soar like the great skyscrapers do today. And there's always the danger of fire. And that's what the apostle talks about in this passage. He says, the foundation is there. Now, what are you going to build on it? Be careful, because of the fire. Be very concerned about the fire. And what's he talking about? He says, for the day will declare it. The day will reveal it. Day, capital D. He could mean there, the day of a fiery trial in your life. And you never know when it's going to come. It could come this week. This week, you could go into work tomorrow, and about 4:30, when the day is almost over, they give you your notice, and it came out of nowhere. You've lost your job. Or you come home, and your spouse has left. You go to the doctor, and you think it's a routine visit, but he saw something, and he wants you to come in so you can talk about it. Or somebody passes away. And you knew that was going to happen. They'd lingered for days in the hospital. Hank Poole died last night. One of our longtime members died. It happens. And suddenly your world is turned upside down and everything is shaken. What's your foundation? That trial will reveal it, just like a hurricane coming through reveals the strength of your roof. A great freeze comes along and tests your insulation. The day will declare it. You can't prepare for it when it happens. You know, it's too late then. You've got to have the right building now so you're ready for the fiery trial. It could mean that, but most likely the apostle is talking about the day, the big day, the day of judgment. The judgment seat of Christ, when we will stand before Him. And you know what He's going to ask, don't you? You're a Christian, so you're in heaven, but you know what He's going to ask you? He's going to say, now, I see that you became a Christian when you were 9 years old at First Baptist Church of Alexandria. And I see that you went on this mission trip and that mission trip. But what happened when you left for college? What happened in your 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s? What kind of life did you build? The question is going to be, what did you build on the foundation given you? I want to challenge you today to make sure you've got the foundation. Give your life to Christ and then commit yourself today that you're going to build with only the best of materials for God's glory. Let's pray. Would you bow with me, please? We're going to sing in a moment, and I'm going to encourage anybody here that wants today to be sure that foundation is there. You're ready today to give your life to Christ. I want you to come. We'll pray with you. It can happen right here when you say yes to Him. Maybe you've done this privately, and that's good. That's where it has to start, but you've never told anybody about it. We give you the chance to walk down this aisle, and by doing that, you're saying, I believe too. I'm a Christian too, and we can baptize you in weeks to come. And if there's somebody here today who wants to be a part of a church like this, you come and present yourself. If you want somebody just to pray with you, we'll be happy to do that today. Father, speak to every heart in life and call people to yourself. Lord, I pray that no one today will leave without having the foundation they need for their life. Jesus Christ. In His name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and we sing together.
Please pray with me. Lord God, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for a chance to come together. Thank you, Lord, for Christ being our foundation. Thank you for this church home where we can grow together, love each other, build each other up, and secure a future, Lord, where you can tell us, well done, good and faithful servant. Lord, we thank you for these tithes and offerings that are about to be given. We pray that they glorify you and further your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you.